Good evening, everyone, and welcome to our November Benedictine conversation entitled The Church Today, Where Do We Go From Here? I'm Dawn Carrillo. I'm the director of the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment, which is a ministry of the Sisters of St. Scholastica here in Duluth, Minnesota. We're delighted with our guest this evening, Father Timothy Joyce, who I will introduce more fully in just a moment. Just a little reminder, as in previous Benedictine conversations, and if you're new to this space, we welcome you all here and encourage you to put your view on speaker view for Zoom. It gives you the best picture. And if you ever have a comment or question, you can send it in by chat. And I'll be watching the chat for any comments or questions that come in for Father Tim. And at some point during the conversation between Father Tim and myself, I will invite you for questions and comments, but you can really send them in anytime. So we're going to begin this evening with a prayer. And when I was thinking about this evening, as we're talking about the future of the church, as with declining, there's a lot of sadness out there with declining attendance, declining religious affiliation, and it can seem very sad, sometimes almost like a little bit of a death. And so I came across this blessing prayer that I want to share with you by Jan Richardson, just to get us started off correctly tonight. And this is entitled Blessing When the World Is Ending. And so we pray. Look, the world is always ending somewhere. Somewhere the sun has come crashing down. Somewhere it has gone completely dark. Somewhere it has ended with the gun, the knife, the fist. Somewhere it has ended with the slammed door, the shattered hope. Somewhere it has ended with the utter quiet that follows the news from the phone, the television, the hospital room. Somewhere it has ended with a tenderness that will break your heart. But listen, this blessing means to be anything but morose. It has not come to cause despair. It is simply here because there is nothing a blessing is better suited for than an ending. Nothing that cries out more for a blessing than when a world is falling apart. This blessing will not fix you, will not mend you, will not give you false comfort. It will not talk to you about one door opening when another one closes. It will simply sit itself beside you among the shards and gently turn your face toward the direction from which the light will come, gathering itself about you as the world begins again. Amen. I'd like to introduce to you Father Timothy Joyce, a Benedictine monk and priest from Glastonbury Abbey in Hingham. Did I say that right? Hingham? Hingham, Massachusetts. Father Tim has a licentiate in sacred theology from Gregorian University in Rome. He's a lecturer, a writer, and he has a fantastic monthly blog entitled Monastic Scribe. He's a spiritual director, he leads pilgrimages, and oversees the Abbey Library. He's been at Glastonbury Abbey since 1976. We are so honored to have you here tonight, Father Timothy. Welcome.
Thank you very much, Dawn. And greetings to all your sisters and brothers who are joined with us this evening for a little reflection on the church and the future. I'm glad to be with you. I'm in sunny, warm Massachusetts, at least today.
That's so wonderful.
Where are we going to start, Dawn?
We are going to start with hearing a little bit about you. We'd like to hear a little bit about you and the work you do. Anything you'd like to tell us?
Okay. Glastonbury Abbey is a small community. We're about 20 miles south of Boston, midway between Boston and Cape Cod. We're about a mile in from the ocean. It's rather a nice old New England area. I've been here since 76, and the monastery has been here since 1954. Mm. We are a foundation from the Midwest, from Bennett Lake Abbey in Wisconsin, in 1954. When the monastery first opened, it followed the example of Bennett Lake in offering a Latin school that is offering Latin, Greek, the basics, for those who didn't have these subjects before the Vatican Council made them unnecessary. Since then, our main ministry is more or less hospitality. Since we are in a relatively developed area, the town of Hingham itself has about 20,000 people. And we're, about 20 miles from Boston. We run a retreat house. We run a lot of programs, institute lectures, and different kind of social and educational events. And that's my field. I'm very much in educational outreach. I am on the committees of the listening to other voices. Our interfaith lecture series has been going for 23 years. And this is a wonderful series that we have, bringing in people from different faith traditions to speak on different topics. And we also have the Glastonbury Institute, which is an umbrella group, setting up lectures, evening prayers, Saturday long retreats, so forth. So I'm involved in both of those. I write a blog, as Dawn says, which actually comes out twice a month, every other Friday.
Oh,
but, yeah. But I'm skipping it this week because of Thanksgiving. So next Friday will be the next one. And I write for a group in Boston run by a Jesuit called Faith Doing Justice. I write a weekly column for them and write homilies. So, I write the intercessions for Sunday, so I spend a lot of time on my desk and get out when I can, particularly after lunch for a good walk. I love getting out. Hingham is blessed with a lot of open space and the trees and the river and everything else feeds me very much. So I'm very much a person of the outdoors. So that's what I'm doing. I'm getting older. I have less energy. But I do what I'm doing what I can. Our monastery, by the way, only has 8 monks.
We've
lost 3 in the past 23 months.
Oh my.
So, but we have a tremendous number of lay people working with us. We unofficially call them lay associates, in addition to oblates, and they are involved in these 2 committees that I'm talking about, and many, the social development committee. We have an advisory board that has lay people. So we are very much involved with the laity. And that's important for us as we look at our future.
Yeah.
Where the laity are going to fit into it. So that covers more or less what I'm doing, who I am, I think. If you have any questions.
For that. I'm curious where you grew up.
Where did I grow up? I'm a New Yorker.
A New Yorker. Okay.
In Queens, one of the boroughs of the city of New York.
Uh-huh.
And from my rooftop, I could see the Empire State Building.
Cool.
And it was a little neighborhood. There was hardly anything urban about it.
Mm-hmm.
We would talk about going to the city. That's Manhattan. You know, and to go there two or three times a year would be a big event for a kid, you know. So I have good memories of New York.
Yeah, thank you.
My accent may come through occasionally.
Right.
I'm not a New Englander.
No.
Yeah.
I'd like to dig right into where are we going? What is going on with the church today? I was reading an article about a Gallup poll. A recent Gallup poll said that only 47% of Americans now belong to a church, a synagogue, or a mosque, which is down 20 points from the turn of the century. That is hugely significant. And then there's an average attendance at most churches, at, you know, across the board churches, of 28%, 28% attendance. Those are stark numbers and distressing numbers. So what's going on? What are we facing?
Well, what are we facing? I have more questions than answers to give you. And I rely on the Holy Spirit to break through in ways that we do not see yet. But I think, first of all, when we talk about the church, the American church seems to be in a much worse situation than many other parts of the world. Mm. We are really polarized. A whole group that is more political in its association with far-right groups,
mm-hmm.
and white supremacy and so forth. They're very fearful, and they don't want change. And then we have others that are essentially much more devoted to Pope Francis and the Second Vatican Council. So we have this division, and the bishops show it too. The bishops who met last week are elected as the new president, somebody who is very cold, if not against Pope Francis. They really represent a different way. So what do I do with all of that?
Yeah.
And, you know, I think the Pew survey also says that by 2070, Christians are going to be a minority in the United States. And those who clamor, particularly this first group I'm talking about, that we should get back to being a Christian nation. I'm not sure we ever were a Christian nation.
Mm.
We indulged in slavery and the violent uproot of an indigenous people. You know, to call ourselves Christians is pretty stretching things pretty far.
Mm-hmm.
So what's going to happen? Well, part of me says, it's going to die. They're just going to die. But I also believe in resurrection. If it dies, a new church will emerge. The Holy Spirit is working for sure. Now, I say that with great hesitation because I think most people are good. Most Catholics are good, you know, and they're just trying to make sense of their lives, you know, and don't have a... You know, Catholics have not been well educated.
Right.
Really, they haven't, you know. And that's part history. History is very important. We are an immigrant church, and based on the local church being an ethnic group that held people together. as they came into this country, they settled it in groups in this part of the country, mostly Irish and Italian, Polish, and so forth, and probably more German and Scandinavian where you are, as far as I know.
A lot, yeah.
Yeah, and then with the middle of the 20th century, a lot of this fell apart. People here, at least, moved out of the city. The inner city parish became dried up. That was a real social community place, inner city parishes. And people moved to the suburbs and so forth and became more independent, affluent, you know. So we've been struggling for that kind of thing. And the church has gone on as though nothing has changed. You know, we changed the language of the Mass and certain customs like that. But as far as how to bring people together, we really have not changed. So I don't know where this is going to go. But I'm certain that it has to go back to the basics. Church is built on Jesus Christ. And I think part of the post-Reformation spirituality, for Protestants, the Bible was everything. For Catholics, the church was everything.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we wanted any kind of answer, a question, we'd go to a priest, we'd go to the bishop, we'd go to the pope. You know, we depended on the church, whom we built up kind of as having all the answers and being correct and so forth. You know, and so much of that has been destroyed. The report from this American Synod group that came out about a month ago, you know, which the American bishops have released to their credit, says there's three big wounds in the American church.
Mm-hmm.
One is the sexual abuse crisis, which is not ended yet. This past week, the Archdiocese of Baltimore announced that 160 priests now have been revealed to be predators. It's just still unraveling. And then the second thing they point out, the wound, is that the American people, Catholics, don't trust the bishops.
Right.
They don't feel the bishops understand them, or and a lot of the Catholics feel that the bishops are disloyal to the Pope, and so they're just dismissing them. And the third wound is the marginalization of young people and women. So we have these kind of issues to deal with. And for me, where I've been going the last few months in my preaching and teaching is that we've got to get back to Jesus Christ. He has to be the center. If the church can fall apart, but Jesus has to be the one that we love and loves us. We have to have this personal, intimate knowledge of Jesus Christ and the human Jesus Christ. We grew up with a doctrinal kind of thing that were kind of litmus tests. I believe in the Trinity, I believe in the Incarnation, and we really had no idea what they meant. We just believed that they were there. I think we have to go back to Jesus as rabbi, as teacher, as prophet, as friend, as brother, as mystic, and come to know Jesus intimately. That has to be the resurrection of the church, but based on Jesus Christ. The rest follows.
When you said back to the basics, you scared me, because in my 25 years of parish work, there were always people saying, we need to get back to the basics, back to the basics. And they were talking about things like the Baltimore Catechism. And so it's really refreshing to hear you speak about this as the basics.
Well, yeah, the 19th century is hardly the basics of 2,000 years of Christianity.
Exactly.
You know, but people who grew up with that's it. That's the basics.
You know? Yes, yes. That's their understanding of tradition, yes.
And this going back to the Tridentine Mass is a betrayal, I think, of Jesus. I put it that strongly. It's giving up on community, really. It's giving up on church. It's me and Jesus, you know, that I want to adore, but not want to really listen to and be open to within this community, you know. That's a little far-fetched, maybe, but.
Well, but that you're saying it's a betrayal because that's not who Jesus was. Jesus did not give up on community.
No, he didn't.
Right.
I mean, Jesus was a loyal Jew to the end.
Yes, he was.
He was a Jew and was trying to reform or bring them back to their basics.
Right, right.
You know, and... it's interesting, this last week of the church year, we have Jesus in the temple now. He's finally come to Jerusalem in Luke's gospel, you know, and the angst you feel and the opposition that's leading where it's leading, you know, to the passion and death and crucifixion. Mm-hmm. You know, it's to take this seriously, it takes Jesus seriously, you know. Yeah. So I'm dismayed that people walk away from the church, and they are doing that.
Yes.
And I understand why. There's many good reasons. But that they leave Jesus Christ behind. This is sad. Very sad to me.
And in that same vein, I read a startling article that was saying that 48% of millennials in the millennial generation are considered post-Christian in their beliefs, their thinking, and their worldview. So that taken in context with a question that has come in from someone, Greg writes, I'm a-okay with the thought that the church as we know it may die. My question is, how can we engage the youth of today in the resurrection of the new church? So that question with this statistic that 48% of millennials are behaving in their lives in a post-Christian way, in their beliefs, thinking, and worldview. Would you comment on that?
Well, some would say that we've already lost two generations. They're just out, you know, then the church is completely irrelevant or even negative, and it's hypocritical, and the sexual abuse crisis has made this so much more difficult. What's going to happen? Well, it can go either way. They may refine in their search for Jesus Christ and the community, or, heaven help us, they may fall for some cult.
Yeah.
You know, who would give easy answers, you know, to follow me and do this. So I'm afraid of that. So we can't do anything to make these young people church people again. We just have to make it sense to believe.
Yeah.
The Pope says, you know, that evangelization does not mean we're going out to convert everybody. Evangelization is to show people the joy of the gospel, the joy of being a believer. You know, and so it's not rules. It's not even going to church every Sunday. You know, it's really a personal following and embracing of Jesus. And of course, that has to show itself in some way. my tendency, the practical thing, is I think people need a small group to belong to.
Mm.
That shares some kind of insights, that pray together, listen to each other, be silent together, you know, and strengthen their faith. Then they also need to belong to the bigger church.
Mm-hmm.
Even if it makes no sense, if they're hypocritical and half of those people in our church, you know, so this is the people of God. This is the other side of getting too small or dying. These are God's people.
Right.
And they're probably hurting, grieving people, you know, and they've never been helped to embrace the real love of God for them. And it's as shown in Jesus Christ. You know? So whatever we can do to bring that about, and I'm trying to do that, you know. I started my blog a year and a half ago when I was really in a state of not quite depression, but just confusion. What can I do? I'm a monk in a monastery. And I turned to Thomas Merton for my own inspiration. As a monk, I can reach out now through the technical means and try to show people there's another way of being Christian. And for that, I have a lot of inspiration from Richard Rohr, who speaks of an alternative orthodoxy, that we are passing on the faith as truly embraced throughout the centuries. It's orthodox, but it's in a different form than rules and abstract lessons and so forth, you know. So get people... just begin to see things a little different, changing their imagery of what it's all about, you know. So that's what I'm trying. I don't know where it's going to go. It's probably not going to go far in my lifetime, but...
Another form of orthodoxy. Tell me what that looks like. What does that look like in my life?
It means that we are not an exclusive set apart group. We are the seed in the midst. We're the leaven, and our call, our faith, our baptism is not to escape from this world. It's to pray, your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. Because of the whole Middle Ages, the Black Plague, and the Protestant Reformation, and so forth, so much emphasis on prayer and practice was to get to heaven.
Right.
You know, just to keep the rules, you know, and you know, add some practices like First Fridays and things like that. You know, right. And you'll have all your merits stored up. You know, an alternative orthodoxy is no, we have to be human, and we're going to fail, but we have to try harder to love one another, to forgive one another, to be more compassionate to one another, whether they're Catholic, Jews, Muslims, or whatever. You know. I think that's alternative from what I grew up with.
That's interesting. Yeah, it is. It's very different. Yes. So you said, this ties into what you just said. You said in a recent blog posting that since you've gotten older, it matters not so much what you do, but who you are.
Correct.
I was wondering if you could say more about that and how. Well,
part of that is because I'm older and because
and
I have.
Wiser.
Hmm?
And wiser.
Well, I hope so. I hope so. And that aspect of, you know, I don't have to earn God, I don't have to earn merits or grace I don't have to earn any of that. It's all given. God absolutely loves me, no matter what. And in fact, the more I can acknowledge my problems, my sins, my defects, the more God will love me.
Mm.
You know, I don't have to hide any of that, you know. So I'm trying to let God be God, as people can be. Because God loves me. Excuse me, I have a little saying on my desk. This is from St. Therese of Lisieux. If you are willing to bear serenely the trial of being displeasing to yourself, then you will be for Jesus a pleasant place of shelter.
Wow.
I live with my imperfections and lack of love and compassion and know God still loves me, then I am being freed to actually be a more loving, compassionate person. I don't have to pretend before God that I'm something that I'm not.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a flawed, hurt, scarred human being. That's kind of what I mean. But so it's, and you know, the call to contemplative prayer, centering prayer, however you do it, is to let God love me.
In your brokenness.
In my brokenness, and accept it. As you know, as one person said, let God gaze on you as you gaze on God. Simple, you know. So stop earning, stop adding prayers, as Jesus said, just be before God.
Mm.
And as you say, with age and wisdom, that becomes a little easier because you're running out of energy to try to build up something which isn't, you know, keeping your false self alive. You know, after a while, it's not worth it. I can't do that anymore.
Mm.
You know, relax. And let God love you. You know, and we haven't done that as a church. We've emphasized merit and earning and keeping the rules, you know, and, you know, it's a sin if you don't get to Mass on Sunday. It's a sin if you don't do this, you know, like that. You know, it's been all so negative, and so many people still are weighed down with this negativity, you know.
They are.
Again, Richard Rohr says that so much of religion has been an insurance policy. You know, I'm putting the time and effort in so I get to the next life, you know. You know, and Jesus, the Sermon on the Mount, you know, and his public teaching was all about relationship. How you love God, your neighbor, and yourself. And I would add today, how we love the earth.
Mm-hmm.
So am I roaming on a bit too much?
No, I was just thinking about how loving God, loving myself, loving God, loving others, loving the earth, seems like that's getting back to the basics too.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah, and I find nature so important for that now.
Mm-hmm.
You know, my good part of my prayer, you know, we have some wonderful parks here at Hingham. I go out and just sit and look at the trees.
Mm.
You know, and I know God is in all of this.
Yeah.
You know, and we've messed things up so badly, you know.
Hmm.
Oh.
Yeah. I'm wondering, the people that you work with, the people with whom you engage in dialogue in these wonderful listening sessions. A friend of mine calls them your town hall sessions. And what do they tell you about the church? What do they tell you about what the church should be doing?
Well, what's obvious from these sessions is that we have to listen.
Yeah.
And the Pope is saying that, you know, the bringing up the sense of the faithful, you know, which was in the Second Vatican Council.
Sense of Cyrillium, yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, to really listen, you know, and that's what I try to do with these sessions, you know, not judge, not correct. And I, nor has there been need to. People are expressing their hurts, and, you know, and their struggles, you know, and just need, another word the Pope uses a lot, is accompaniment. We just have to accompany mm-hmm. people, not give them all the answers. That's what I'm learning. I've only had two of these sessions so far. I'm going to have another one in December. And I started with trepidation, you know, and I had all sorts of checks, you know, ready to mute people, ready to knock them out, you know, if they got cantankerous. Nobody does that. You know, the first session was on the church, you know, and an article that's saying, Valerie Schultz, why I can't go back to church anymore. Boy, did people resonate.
Wow.
But one of our staff members who was coordinating the technical part listened to the whole thing, and at the end she said, I'm amazed that there was no anger.
Hmm.
People are not angry, they're hurting.
Yeah. Wait, what do you think people are really seeking from the church?
What they are really seeking, is love.
Okay.
To know I am loved, and that to recognize that I love God. I'm in this loving relationship, because everything comes down to relationship.
Yes.
We talked about people and the earth and myself. Yes. You know, it's relating and. You know, in love, and love means compassion, love means forgiveness, love means acceptance, love means non-judgmentalism, you know. Those are the kind of things that are hard to learn because they're so opposed to so much of what we learned growing up, you know.
And they're very different from the way our society operates.
Well, exactly.
Yeah.
The other big thing we haven't mentioned, you know, the church has been at fault, certainly from the things we mentioned, but our society is sick. And it has its own God in commerce and economics mm-hmm. and consumerism. And, you know, these young people that are angry at the church and don't want to be told how to live and what to do, accept it from commerce. They're being told every day what they should believe, what they should value. All the commercials are our value system. You know, we are really brainwashed. We don't know it. That's why we need Jesus. We really need the church. You know, I just read today someplace, you know, if we don't honor someone beyond us, God, we will substitute an honor and adore something else.
And they're a lot, big business is a lot better at marketing than the church.
Terrible, yeah.
They
have destabilized ourselves. They've closed factories, they've moved people here and there, you know. And we seem to take that. That's the American way of life. But you know, Jesus is offering something different.
I want to just take a moment to invite people to send in your comments and questions for for Father Tim. We have another one from Greg. He says, Tim, Pope Francis, Richard Rohr, and Thomas Merton are obvious mentors to you. Me also. Can you name a female theologian or two you find to be good mentors as well? I resonate with your theology as you promote loving relationships, certainly of Jesus and within the body of Christ. Females, female
theologians. Ilia Delio would be an important
person. Ilia Delio, yes, yes.
Elizabeth Johnson, though she's retired, is still a wonderful theologian, you know. And you know, there's more female theologian now than probably male. But, you know, we're not getting the names out, you know.
Right.
They have the influence. You know, if you read the Press, America, Commonweal, Tablet, Le Monde, it's full of women writing.
Mm. Particularly in the area of eco-spirituality.
Eco-spirituality, yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And again, the personal, relational
mm-hmm. aspect. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So what do you say to someone who comes and says to you, Tim, why do I need faith? Why would I need a faith community? What are your thoughts about that?
Exactly how I would say this, it would depend very much on what I'm hearing and exactly how it's phrased. Because again, I don't want to be judgmental. Mm-hmm. And say, you know, you don't get it, do you? You know, you know, it's the lesson, and it's hard for Americans especially, is that we're not individuals. We're not separate individuals. There's an interconnection and interdependence on everything that exists, on all people. We need each other. We need each other very, very badly, you know. And without others, we can be so delusional, you know.
Yeah.
What I wrote in my column this past week about a monastic life, you know, needing to be in community, because we really need to get to know ourselves. Mm-hmm. And you can't know yourself without other people knocking you at you some ways and calling you crazy or whatever it is. You know, it makes you really look at why I'm saying what I do and so forth. You know, so I don't know if that answers, but that's the direction I would go.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you. So one of the things I wonder about is so in the opening blessing, in the part where she says that you'll be surrounded by this light and that your face will be gently turned toward the light, instead of a trite thing like, well, when God closes one door, God will open another one. So that's the accompaniment we're talking about. But the light, I was very caught by that image in that blessing prayer. And so I'm wondering for you, where is that light? In the midst of this conversation, the context of what's happening in the church, where's the light?
The light, first of all, is so obvious in nature.
Mm.
I mean, literally, I mean, I sit in my chair here by the window, and the sun is not rising now till about 20 to 7. Mm-hmm. I sit out and I see it start dappling on the trees, you know, light growing, you know, just, oh my God, oh my God. Good morning, God, I say, you know.
Yeah.
You know, it's kind of overwhelming, you know, and I've been reading books by Belden Lane, L-A-N-E, And one book is called Backpacking with the Saints. And he does a lot of outdoor camping. But interestingly enough, he always brings something to read that corresponds to what he's sensing. And he read the mystics, read the desert fathers and mothers, you know, and hear them through nature. Boy, oh boy, I'm not that far. That I'm bringing together. But so that's, nature is an important thing to remind us who we are and how we're interdependent. As all of this nature we're looking at is interdependent. Every tree needs the other tree and so forth. But then it's each other. You know, again, learning to be patient and understanding and compassionate to people who are hurting. And everybody is hurting in some way. You know, and to be understanding, you know, and slow to judge, you know, pursuing justice, certainly, but not vengeance, not hurt. You know, so the light shines in people. I'm overwhelmed sometimes by when I learn of some people's lives. You know, some people I see every day, I have no idea what they're going through. You find out, you know, how does she do this? You know, people are carrying big burdens, you know, and hurts. And, you know, to see, to sense that in another person is, boy, God is with that person. God is within. The light is there. You know, and maybe somebody needs to help her know that. Which again, as opposed, our cultural structure is we're all individuals and you make it on your own.
Pull up your bootstraps. Right.
It's so opposed to our interdependence and need of each other.
Well, it's even opposed to the context of understanding that Jesus would have lived in.
Yeah.
His understanding would have been primarily of community. That
sure.
So it's interesting how we interpret Jesus so individualistically.
Yep. You see pictures of some of these immigrant groups struggling to come across the border or just to exist, you know, and how they need each other.
Yes.
On each other, you know. And then when they meet somebody, you know, like there's some sisters on our border in New Mexico, Arizona, you know, that greet them and welcome them. Wow. That's God.
And our church could play such a huge role in forming us in this way. When you mentioned a little while ago the problems that were stated that came out of the synod, sex abuse, lack of trust in the bishops, what was the third one?
Marginalization of women.
Marginalization. Do you see a way forward with the church?
It's happening, yes. It's happening. It's happening on different levels. It's happening in the Vatican, even with opposition. You know, there's a lot more recognition of women, and the Pope is quietly bringing more and more, and he's not making a fuss about it.
No, he's being kind of sneaky.
he's a sly guy. He doesn't change the rules and the doctrine and so forth, but he just ignores them. I mean, we were supposed to have James Martin here last week for a lecture.
Yes.
He couldn't come because he was in Rome.
Mm-hmm.
He's been made a member of in the Curia of the Communications Department.
Mm-hmm.
And he had to spend two extra days there than was planned, as we missed our talk, because the Pope wanted to meet with him. So the Pope hasn't changed the theory or the teaching about gay marriage or, you know, the place, anything. But in practice, he's embraced them.
Yeah.
You know, we had about 5 or 6 people complain to us, how could you have James Martin? Good Catholics, I'm sure.
Yeah. And a lot of that is misunderstanding. And like you said earlier, we've not done a good job teaching our people.
Yeah. I mentioned before how I think grief is underneath so much of people, what they've lost, what they don't have anymore. And fear follows. Fear is so big in our country. And trying to preserve, hold on, you know, to the old ways and so forth. It's just,
right.
You know, again, going back to St. Therese, you know, just deal with the
serenity. She used the word serenity, yeah. Circumstance or something.
Right. Serenity, the trial of being displeasing to yourself. I love it. I'm displeasing to myself a lot. I get in bed at night and say, oh my God, why did I waste so much time today? Or, you know, how I wasn't kind to everybody, you know. It was so clear to me at that time of day when I have nothing else to do except get to bed and go to sleep, you know. And it
hits you.
And to let go of that, you know, and trust God, you know. I can go to sleep. I can go to sleep, God. And you remember Pope John the 23rd, his prayer at night, he said, dear God, it's time. I have to go. I'm tired and have to go to sleep. You have to take care of the church overnight.
Right.
I mean, he was just wonderful that way.
Yes. And then his quote of, here I am toward the end of the journey, or at what did he say? I'm at the top of the heap and end of the journey, or he was making light of his being.
My bags are packed. I'm ready to go, he said.
You know, Sister Lois, who is one of the sisters at St. Scholastica Monastery, says, thank you, Timothy, for being such a beautiful messenger of God's unconditional love for us all.
Boy, and more people knew that, I think, God's unconditional love. We can put up with anything in this life if we really know we're loved.
We really knew that. You know, you mentioned earlier about one of your practices of going for a walk and sitting in the park. And I imagine you have some special trees that you yep. say hi to and so forth, which is a beautiful practice to come to know what we think of as inanimate objects, right? And to know the presence of God throughout all of creation. Are there other practices that you engage in, or that you think would be effective for people to know about? Anything else you can think of?
Well, silence, of course. Just cool it.
That's really tough for us 21st century Americans, huh?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Yeah.
Letting go and letting God be. And that verse I just quoted from Psalm 46, verse 10, be still and know that I am God. And Richard Rohr always ends prayers often saying, be still and know. Be still. Be. You know, a little practices like that kind of help you to let go.
Beautiful.
Yeah. I also like St. Francis's prayer. Supposedly every night he's prayed, God, tell me who you are. and tell me who I am.
Mm.
You know, we live, I'm an individual despite everything, and you know, life is overwhelming.
Yeah, it is.
You know, so much going on. And to really trust God is the bottom line. The absolute bottom line. No matter what's going on, that God is there and God loves me. You know, I realize people will say, well, if God loved you so much, why does he permit this? I don't know. I don't understand God. I don't know God really. But I've experienced God enough. I don't know him or her. I have experienced the presence of God in fleeting moments where the light does come on and so forth. When I see the beauty in another human being and in nature, I know God's with me.
Mm.
You know, and one of the most powerful elements of my priesthood is with dying people.
Mm.
I've had people die in my arms. And if that isn't a powerful experience.
Mm.
There's one time a man was laboring to breathe. He had a mask on. And he said to him, where's Jesus? And I said, Bill, he's right here. And he said, oh. He took off the mask and died. So those are powerful moments. So they're there and they're around us, you know. If we're not afraid to be open to be, because, you know, God is also in suffering.
Yeah. Well, this hour has flown by and it's time for us to be done. That's a beautiful, beautiful place to conclude. And I thank you so much. I'm wondering, after our discussion, if there's some final words you'd like to leave us with.
I don't know what I can add, you know, except the simplicity of let God love you and love God in return.
Hmm. It's a beautiful message as we celebrate Thanksgiving.
Yes.
It's a day of gratitude and thanks for all the blessings in our lives. Thank you so much for being here, Tim. This has been really beautiful, very touching and lovely. Thank you. Thank you so much.
I enjoyed being with you.
And I want to thank all our guests for being here. We wouldn't be here were it not for you. And so thank you for being here and thank you for participating in this time as we think about where the church is going and where our society is going. I want to let everyone know our next Benedictine conversation will be on December 20th. So watch for our emails on that. Our guest will be Sister Joan Chittister from the Benedictine Sisters of Erie, Pennsylvania. And on behalf of the Sisters of St. Scholastica and the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment, I want to just reach out to everyone and wish you all a blessed and joyous Thanksgiving. Thank you all.
Same to you all.
Good night, Tim.
Good night.
Night.